I met Fred Curran, my son's daughter. I have a picture taken of her and me on my desk in my study at church. But most of us don't think about that the same way we don't think about the Elaine race massacre. You understand, when you're used to people stealing land, you don't think about people stealing land when it happens around you. And so we have to have new thinking, because our old way of thinking has gotten us so messed up that we don't think about land theft when it happens in our state. We don't talk about land theft when you have town states. We don't even teach about land theft. And we don't preach about it. We got "thou shalt not steal" in our Bibles, and we got big 80 Bibles and big A churches with big A steeples, but they don't talk about the big A theft that has gone on in this country against people of color. So we have to shift our thinking. But one reason we have done so is because the prevailing thought in American law and culture regarding white supremacy and racism is based on what a social ethicist named Robert Terry, T-E-R-R-Y, called the rightness of whiteness. Basically, if white folks do it, it's right. And therefore, the theft of indigenous land, the theft of land from Mexican people in the Southwest, you understand that we still have folks learning about the Alamo as part of a war with Mexico, when actually the United States invaded Mexico? Southerners invaded Mexico to trigger the war, and then the federal government sent the troops down, and what happened? Texas, Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, Nevada, California, Wyoming, added to the, you had more than the loose end of purchase stolen. We still talking about the weapons of mass destruction that folks didn't find in Iraq. Nobody talks about the masses weapons of mass misconstruction, about the history we teach, about the way we got half the country. So if we're used to stealing the land from the Indians, and we're used to stealing the land from Latinx people, and we're used to stealing the labor from the black folks, we don't get upset about stealing land in Elaine. Our thinking is, as the young folks say, jacked up. Okay? And that's the popular term. You know, I say, WTF, what is this foolishness? I said new thinking. Second thing is new leadership. Somebody say new leadership. First thing was what? Second thing is what? There you go. Any contemplation about white supremacy and racism has to also admit that we have to have some new leadership. Otherwise, we're going to continue following the leadership that produced the last 200, almost 300 years of mess. And new leadership has to come from people with a worldview defined by the experiences of the historical victims of white supremacy and racism, rather than the historical beneficiaries of it. And whatever their racial ancestry may be, and white people can do this, white people can be the agents of this new thinking along with people of color. The new leadership must not only think new, but leadership must also approach issues about white supremacy and racism and land theft that have not affected, but contaminated, polluted, poisoned our legal system, our economic system, our educational system, our political system, and our religious systems. First of all, let's just admit something. Some of the leadership problems we've had come from folks who talk about need to have colorblind stuff. I want you to think about what that means. If you know anything about health, you know that colorblindness is a disability. It is not a virtue. If you're colorblind, you can't get a CDL job. Right, okay. If you're colorblind, you can't be a pilot. Commercial. If you're colorblind, you are not more healthy. You have a if you're colorblind, you need to have some help to see right. And so we have these people who are still talking about needing the colorblind. The Arkansas General Assembly, God bless the little heads. I heard folks talking about we get to have colorblindness. I'm thinking, what idiot school did you go to? That colorblindness makes you see better. Hello? Now I know I'm crazy. Okay, but at least I'm smart to know that colorblindness does not make you see better. Colorblindness means you can't see right. And you especially can't see right about stuff that involves color. So the idea that colorblindness is going to qualify somebody to be a leader concerning an issue that is color-centric is not only wrong, it is nonsense. It is idiocy. It is haberdash. It is foolish. It is, I would use some of the military terms, but I have an audience here that will not allow me to use military terms, but the military terms, those in the military terms, that is. So somebody will say, WTF. And I would say, WTF, when we see our legislature talking about being colorblind. Besides me. The idea that we have colorblind justice is wrong. Excuse me? If we had colorblind justice, we would have just as high a proportion of people who are white getting in prison as people who are not white. Because law breaking is law breaking. But we don't have that, do we? Part of the problem is the judges. You know I don't talk about judges, did we? I've been a judge and I know I got some experience with my judges. Let me give you another homework assignment. I told you I was gonna tell you the truth. A reading assignment for you. If you're taking notes, find this book titled Black Robes, White Justice. Black Robes, White Justice, written by Bruce Wright, W-R-I-G-H-T. Came out in 1987. Don't buy it from the guy who owns Amazon. He got enough money. find a local independent bookstore, because the money stays in your community, okay? And buy it from them. If you don't have one, buy it from the bookstore I go from. Pyramid Books, Arts and Custom Framing, 1001 Wright Avenue, Little Rock, Arkansas. Tell them Griffen sent you. I'm not paying for your book. Bruce Wright in White Robes, White Justice wrote this: those of us called upon to sit in judgment of both laws and lawbreakers are not always qualified for such an onerous task. Most of the judges in America are male, white, middle class, aloof, and conservative. Brought before them is a parade of dark-skinned defendants, all alien to the concept that the judges have of the way life ought to be. In New York City, as well as Hot Springs and Arkansas, most judges have completed 4 years of college and 3 of law school. Presumably, such scholars are intellectuals of one kind or another, but more often than not, they are acquainted with no more than theories. Seldom do they have any personal familiarity with the reality and cruel actions which modify and diminish the lives of the poor. Such judges gaze upon the captives of the police across a vast expanse of social distance. And then Bruce Wright adds, my persistent concern has long been the white judges who, in their large numbers, are called upon daily to preside over the trials of black defendants accused of crime. Are they really qualified for such sociological tasks, only incidentally mixed with law? If so, what are the peculiar circumstances that define their competence? Is it survival in them of some plantation concept of social divisions in life? What they study in college or law school that might tend to qualify them to preside over the doom or liberty of strangers to their kinds of neighborhoods, of aliens to their folk ways and their way of life, of foreigners and outsiders to their clubs and their churches and their communities? What magic abolishes color in their eyes and gives them instant objectivity and a license to analyze human foibles entirely divorced from the historical truth of racism? How indeed does one annul one's heritage and that of one's forefathers in this land or the land from which this family came? Do white judges ever bring to bear a sober reflection on why there are so many black defendants in criminal cases? Do white judges ever wonder why there are so few black lawyers appearing in court? Do they ever think about the history of bar associations that used to exclude Jews and blacks? Do they ever ponder aloud or in silence that there are so few black judges? New leadership. I used to practice law with a fellow from Hot Springs named Clinton. Got to be president. I like him. My friend. When he was president, he had a race initiative. One would have thought that his race initiative would have included a serious discussion of the issues that Bruce Wright mentioned. After all, the initiative was launched out of a professed desire by President Clinton to create honest and intelligent answers and conversations about racism and racial injustice and the prospects for changing our history. But go back and check the record. The leadership issue was never mentioned in the President Clinton's racial initiatives. The leadership issue was not mentioned. Two other areas of leadership must change also. I talk about judges, talk about presidents. And that must involve the so-called white moderate and the white religious community. Yeah, I'm going there. And now I'm going to quote our favorite Negro, our favorite black person, our Martin Luther King Jr. Dr. King letter from Birmingham jail is what people like to talk about. I always wonder why people make students recite the I Have a Dream speech, but never have them recite King's letter from Birmingham jail. Have you ever wondered about that? You do know that Dr. King made a speech after 1963. He made it so. How many of you read Dr. King's letter from Birmingham jail? Raise your hand. Okay. Not enough. Not enough. But when you go home, go into your search engine, whether it's the G word or something else, and enter a letter from a Birmingham City jail. Letter from Birmingham City jail. Since some of you have read it, I bought a little excerpt for you. King wrote that letter in response to an open letter that eight prominent so-called liberal white Alabama clergy people had issued, which called on King to cease his policy of nonviolent civil disobedience in Birmingham, Alabama. And he addressed the problem in the letter. He wrote it from the jail. He wrote it from the jail. He was in jail and he smuggled the letter out. And here's what he wrote. I must make two honest confessions to you, my Christian and Jewish brothers. First, I must confess that over the years, I have been greatly disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's greatest stumbling block in the strive toward freedom is not the White Citizens Council or the Ku Klux Klan, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, I agree with you in your goal you seek, but I can't agree with your methods of direct action, who paternalistically rails that he can set the timetable for another person's freedom, who lives by the myth of time and who constantly advises the Negro to wait until a more convenient season, shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection. Now that'll preach. I dare you to have young people recite that on King's birthday. But King wasn't done, because you know, preachers don't, even when you write, you don't stop. And King wrote, let me rush on to mention my other disappointment. I have been so greatly disappointed with the white church and its leadership. I had the strange feeling when I was suddenly catapulted in the leadership of the bus protest in Montgomery several years ago that we would have the support of the white church. I felt that the white ministers and priests and rabbis of the South would be some of our strongest allies. Instead, some have been outright opponents, refusing to understand the freedom movement and misrepresenting its leaders. All too many have been more cautious and courageous, have remained silent behind the anesthetizing security of stained glass windows. In the midst of a mighty struggle to rid our nation of racial and economic injustice, I have heard so many ministers say those are social issues which the gospel has no real concern. And I've watched so many churches commit themselves to a completely otherworldly religion, which made a strange disconnection between body and soul, the sacred and the secular. We'll talk about where you spend eternity. You need to work out what's going on here. I'm sick and tired of hearing folks talking about where we spend eternity. But then King wrote, I have traveled the length and breadth of Alabama, Mississippi, and all the other southern states. On sweltering summer days and crisp autumn mornings, I've looked at her beautiful churches with their lofty spires pointing heavenward. I have beheld the impressive outlay of their massive religious education buildings. Over and over again, I have found myself asking, what kind of people worship there? Who is their God? Dr. King, man, he wrote that. How many times have you heard white churches have a truth telling about the Elaine Reasoners? Happened in Arkansas. How can we get upset about weapons in Ukraine, but not talk about what happened in Elaine? You have Ukraine days and protests. Don't have Elaine stir. But King wasn't the only person. A white theologian said something. Those of you who know anything about theology know the name Reinhold Niebuhr, one of the great social reformers. Reinhold Niebuhr, one of the great authors, wrote a wonderful book, Moral Man and Immoral Society. Reinhold Niebuhr also wrote something. I read a lot of stuff. He wrote an essay titled The Negro Minority and Its Fate in a Self-Righteous Nation. That was the title I could have used. Niebuhr wrote this. He says, we must examine the illusions of our past. In the first part of this country's history, the child of our nation, we assume we were a peculiar nation. Abraham Lincoln, in his Gettysburg Address, said, our fathers brought forth from this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we engage in a great civil war testing whether this nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. It's the Gettysburg Address. And then Niebuhr noted, it may be significant that Lincoln, though opposed to slavery, did not emphasize the contradiction between the ideal of equality and the frightful inequality of the slave owner and the slaves. And then Niebuhr got real busy. And he said what nobody wants to talk about. He said, after the Civil War, the free slaves were given no livelihood in land ownership. Coming back to you. In land ownership, no opportunity to exercise craft. The same government which passed the Homestead Act and settled white farmers on the frontier with free land gave no land to the poor ex-slaves. They were reduced to the status of debt-ridden sharecroppers on their former plantations. By the 20th century, according to the Kerner Report, the Negro was at the bottom of the American society. Nor were Negroes admitted to the craft unions, Reinhold Niebuhr wrote. And then he writes, after ratification of the 15th Amendment, which did endow them with a vote, Congress enacted several laws to guarantee the equal protection of the law. But they were deprived of this precious democratic power, which the white industrial workers used to such good advantage in curing modern industry of its early injustices. For they were deprived of the right to vote by various devices, such as the poll tax. I still have my parents' 1963 poll tax receipts. My mama died in 2002. We're going through our papers, my sons and I found them. And my son said, Daddy, we need to keep this. So I framed it. And I used to show it to lawyers, come to my study. So you ever seen that? They had. Poll tax, economic intimidation, unconstitutional test. How many marbles in this jar? Was required to recite the provisions of the Constitution. In the South, the Negro was practically disenfranchised. In Louisiana, the number of Negroes registered to vote in 1896 was 130,000. 144. Say it. 130,144. In 1900, 4 years later, after the state rewrote the suffrage provision of its constitution, only 5,320 Negroes were able to be on the registration books. Land theft and political theft. If you steal the labor and you steal the land and you steal the power to vote, then you have stolen the power of a free people to experience the blessings of freedom. And now in 2013, we're still fighting about how we can get votes, because if you don't have a poll tax, you gotta have your driver's license. Then you gotta have this, and your signature's gotta match. Okay, how many of you are older than 50 years old? Does your signature look like it was when you're 25? Okay. My signature looked like it was 5 years ago. So this is the kind of stuff that's going on now. And this is the kind of stuff going on in the 21st century by 21st century leaders. I'm talking about new leadership. Do you hear me? I'm talking about new leadership. If the leadership of the 21st century has the same anti-freedom, anti-democratic, pro-white supremacist leadership thinking of those of past years, we will not go forward. We will simply walk in place at best, walk backwards at worst. Which leads me to my last point. First point was, second point was, third point is new action. Third point, new action. You know, action. Because you understand, if you have new thinking, you have new leadership, and don't act, you have Elaine's going on and on and on again. Oh, by the way, they are happening. They're called gentrification. It's called gentrification. Finally, new thinking and new leadership must produce new action against white supremacy and racial injustice. From the perspective of the historical victims of racism, rather from the perspective of the historical beneficiaries of it. Many of the so-called commentators, social commentators, conservative commentators, some of them are white, not all of them, speak about racial equality issues as if American society is a meritocracy. History clearly proves them wrong. White people enjoy superior access to education, employment, capital, political influence and power, and virtually everything else because policies and practices have historically been developed and employed to favor them at the expense of non-white people. And now I'm going to add a commentation from somebody, and I'm going to ask you to tell me who said this. Somebody wrote, "Why is this issue of equality still so far from the solution in America? A nation that professes itself to be democratic, inventive, hospitable to new ideas, rich, productive, and awesomely powerful. The problem is so tenacious because despite its virtues and its attributes, America is deeply racist and its democracy is flawed, both economically and socially. All too many Americans believe that justice will unfold painlessly, or that its absence for Black people will be tolerated tranquilly. Justice for Black people will not flow into society merely from court decisions, nor from fountains of political oratory. I love Barack Obama's speech, but you know what? You can speak all you want with that power. Powerful speeches don't change stuff. Powerful action changes stuff. No few token changes, this author wrote, quell all the tempestuous yearnings of millions of disadvantaged Black people. White America must recognize that justice for Black people cannot be achieved without radical change, that's what this man said, radical change in the structure of our society. The comfortable, the entrenched, the privileged cannot continue to tremble at the prospect of change in the status quo. Stephen Vincent Benet had a message for both white and Black Americans in the title of the story, "Freedom is a hard-fought thing." When millions of people have been cheated for centuries, restitution is a costly process. Inferior education, poor housing, unemployment, inadequate health care, each is a bitter component of the oppression that has been our heritage. Each will require billions of dollars to correct. Justice, so long deferred, has accumulated interest. And its cost for this society will be substantial in financial as well as human terms. This fact has not been fully grasped because most of the gains of the past have been obtained at bargain prices. You know who said that? You know who wrote that? Martin Luther King Jr. How many of you heard that quote before today? It was published in January 1969. King was murdered April the 4th, 1968. It was published posthumously. It's an essay titled, A Testament of Hope. Write the title now. A Testament of Hope is the title of a book. The complete speeches and addresses of Martin Luther King Jr. You can read it. You know where it was published? It wasn't published in the New York Times. Wasn't published in Ebony? Wasn't published in Life? It was published in Playboy magazine. I know you're gonna say, what are you doing with me now? But you understand, people bought Playboy beside the Sunfold. In the January issue of Playboy magazine, 1969, King's Testament of Hope appeared. People who oppose affirmative action and cite Martin Luther King Jr.'s name, leaders, are either ignorant of what he wrote before he died, or do not give a that he wrote it, thought it, and believed it. That's what I call the reassassination of Martin Luther King Jr. To make him the defender of the status quo when he was actually talking about reparations. Remember what he said? Inferior education, poor housing, unemployment, inadequate health care, each is a bitter component of the oppression that has been our heritage. Each will require billions of dollars to correct. Justice so long deferred has made interest. You can't get folks to have a reparations conversation. You can't get it. They talk about, that's not right. Now, you understand, we stole the land from the native people. We stole the land from African people. And we won't have money. If I steal your wallet, if I steal your purse, keep your purse, take the money in your purse to finance my children's education. My children get a good education. They buy a good house, get a mortgage on the house, pay off mortgage. That means they got wealth, okay? And I come back and give you your purse back in. And say, I'm sorry. Would you think I would have done you a favor? You say, WTF. Wouldn't you? And you probably wouldn't say the nice part of the F. You wouldn't say foolishness. But this is the kind of action we have. We have the kind of action that does not want to have affirmative action for the historical victims. We don't want to have affirmative action for Elaine. We want to have corporate welfare so that any rich person who wants to build a stadium can build a stadium. By the way, you got to be a rich white person to build a stadium. And we pay for it with tax dollars. Hello. Okay, 10-time double dog day to find a bunch of white folks who pay taxes for that a bunch of black folks can get a stadium and play any sports in it and keep the money. I told you I wasn't gonna lie to you, did I? So the new action has to be new thinking and new leadership, but new action has to be the situation I have. New action involves three things. I said new thinking, leadership, new action involves, first of all, character. Character. Because see, there is no Elaine problem. There is no Elaine problem. Just like as Frederick Douglass said, there is no Negro problem. Frederick Douglass said the problem is whether or not the American people have loyalty enough, honor enough, patriotism enough to live up to their own constitution. And the story of Elaine is, do we have loyalty enough, honor enough, patriotism enough to live up to our own constitution? If we believe that stealing is wrong, why can't we say that the people for whom their land and their lives and their ancestors were stolen deserve something from their state besides being ignored? They're not asking for charity. They're asking for what they deserve. How can we have an amber alert for missing children, but can't have an amber alert for the missing people from Elaine? Hundreds of women, men, and children missing. They never got a funeral. Their descendants don't know where they were buried. They can't go to a cemetery to mourn. We got an amber alert when we have any child that's taken from us. We don't have it. We got to have some missing action. We have some action, action, action. Let me remind you something. Action involves change, not just time. I'm sick and tired of hearing people say, we come a long way, got a long way to go. Just takes time. When I was in grade school, I learned a formula of how to compute distance. You recall it? D equals R times T. Anybody remember that? Distance equals rate of travel across space multiplied by time. If you have time but do not move, you don't create distance from where you were. Which explains why we don't have any change. We have time, we don't have distance. So I'll leave you with one of my favorite old TV shows. Most of you are going to know it, but I'll tell you one of my favorite. I got the mic, I'm going to say this. Star Trek. I'm a Trekkie, okay? I'm a Trekkie. Before the Force was with you, I was from Star Trek. Okay. Anybody remember Star Trek? Dr. King's vision for a society and a world where people of color and different languages and cultures and religions and races could live and work together with commonly held purposes was a dream that Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek, came up with. Star Trek had dared us, challenged us to imagine a world, a workplace where women share the responsibilities of command leadership. You call it Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek, Star Trek. Imagine a crew of people on a five-year mission. These are the voyages, the five-year of the Enterprise, whose five-year mission is to boldly go where no one had gone before. Boldly go. You see travel? Go. The crew of the Enterprise were not all white. In 1967, when Star Trek came out, it was not all white. It was not all male. He was not all American. He wasn't even all human. Star Trek brought us to see a Russian named Chekhov in charge of the weapon system, the photon torpedoes that were more powerful than all the nuclear devices we talked about. The idea of a Russian being on a vessel of war with an American captain, and the Russian is in charge of the weapon system? New thinking. New leadership. But you gotta go somewhere. The Enterprise was commanded by a white American named James T. Kirk. His first officer was a guy named Spock from another world at a time when humans had not even placed a person on our own moon. New thinking. The medical doctor, McCoy, was from the South, and his prejudice against the Vulcan Spock was a constant current. He didn't have racial prejudice against black people. He had racial prejudice against another person who was an extraterrestrial. The Enterprise had a communication officer named Uhura. I love Uhura. She was my first girlfriend. She never knew it. An African woman who was present on the command deck of a warship when women were not even allowed in the same unit with men. New thinking, new leadership. The chief engineer was a hard-drinking guy named Scott. Scotty? You call Scotty? The helmsman, the navigator, was an Asian man named Sulu. At a time when the prevailing image of Asians on TV was that of laundry workers or coolies. But that was the kind of new thinking and new leadership that Gene Roddenberry imagined and dared to put on our screens. But the mission of the Enterprise was to go where no one else had gone before. And going always involved challenges. There was a tension between Spock and McCoy. And something was always going wrong with the puzzles. The lithium crystals. Scotty, we need more power. Captain, the lithium crystals are not working right. And there was always a battle between the Klingons, you call the Klingons, the warrior people, and the Romulans, people with political intrigue, also master war. But the idea was that in spite of those challenges, the mission of the Enterprise was to go. And here I'll close by saying, the mission of the Enterprise was not to make speeches. It was not to have sit-down dinners. It was not to have annual days. It was to boldly go where no one had gone before. No one has gone before. The idea of reparations. No one has gone before. The idea of talking about calling things by their right name. Stop calling it a riot. Start calling it a massacre. And say to the educating leaders of this state and the political state that the biggest massacre of people in the state of this, in the history of this state, needs to be called by its right. No one has gone before. No one has gone before saying that we do not need leaders who cannot do that. We've had too many leaders who would not do that. They were popular leaders. They were good-looking leaders. We liked them. They were kinfolks to us. We did not go anyplace because we had too many people doing the same old stuff, spinning in time, walking in place, shut. Daddy said, if you plow the same ground, you're not digging a furrow, you're cutting a trench. And you can't grow a crop in a trench. my friends, truth telling about Elaine means we bear the burden. We bear the burden of insisting on new thinking, new leadership, and new action. If we do that, the next generation of people who talk about Elaine will talk about what we did, and we will be the enterprise. If we don't, next generation people will say, what in the world were they thinking? Or WTF?
There's just been a little bit of a difficulty with the film and a couple of updates here. We're going to change the program slightly. Michael has gone to re-render the film because, as you may have noticed, one of the sound, one of the audio tracks was missing. So we're going to, I think, Christy, are we going to break for lunch at this time? Very well. And I do have some good news. Miss Julia Wright, I have connected with her, so she's going to be available on the Zoom.
Did not our hearts burn? That was wonderful. Call to action. So thank you very much, Judge Griffen. We really appreciate it. Good afternoon, everyone. Is it afternoon yet?
Yes.
Okay. My name is Marcellus Witherspoon. I'm the president of the Hot Springs branch of the NAACP. We are so glad you are here today. There are people from far and from near, from everywhere. So y'all just make us feel real good today coming out and being a part of this event. We really appreciate what you gave to us, Judge Griffen. I'm really inspired, and hopefully you felt the same way. We're gonna have lunch. Is anybody else hungry? So we're gonna get those instructions from my partner, Ms. Christy Rossett. Give her a hand. She's put a lot of blood, sweat, tears into this. So I'm not gonna get between a man and his food. So we're gonna hear instructions for food right now.
We have sack lunches. There's four different wraps that they'll be identified. There's a tuna salad, chicken salad, a turkey bacon ranch,
and a veggie.
You're going to go out the front doors of the theater and take a right, and it's just like the next door over-ish, and it'll be in that space. Pick up your sack lunch. Bring it back here into the theater. There'll be water bottles for you to grab in the lobby of the theater. And as soon as we come back in with our lunch, we're going to get started no later than 1:30, hopefully a little earlier because we're a little off schedule at this point. The plan is that we will start with the Q&A, the panel of descendants with James White, Lenore Marshall, and Julia Wright, who will be zooming in from Paris. And then, should the film be here and ready to roll, we'll go right after that into the documentary and questions and answers after the documentary. That's the plan for now, okay? Thank you very much.
I did want to remind you that after you grab your lunch, we do have a reel of some really interesting stuff to watch. So grab your lunch and come back in. We'll get the projector rolling and get the reel going for everybody too.
And we'll have live music here on stage while you're eating. Thank you.
approved. All right, between bites, we hope you enjoy the Hot Springs Chamber Players. These are my orchestra babies. We have all region players. We have players that have played with the Arkansas Symphony Youth Orchestra. And we're actually auditioning this upcoming Monday for the upcoming season. So I hope that you join us in prayer that we do well. But we're going to play something really quick and get out of your way. This is Blackbird by the Beatles. Enjoy. They're asking to turn down the lights a little because they can't see their faces. Thank you.
welcome you to the panel conversation with Voices of Elaine. One of my big aggravations is that oftentimes the people who have the biggest stake in truth telling aren't allowed to tell their truth, but are talked over. And so I think the planners of this event, who intentionally included the descendants of Elaine, the massacre, so they could tell their truth. You will hear from three descendants. Ms. Lenora Marshall, you've already heard. She was the lady who introduced me. She's the vice president of the Elaine Legacy Center. You'll also hear from Mr. James. I did not do that. I did not do that. Julia Wright is the daughter of Richard Wright. Richard Wright, author of Native Son, author of Black Boy. Chapter 2 of Black Boy, Richard Wright writes about his experience in Elaine and the murder of his uncle, Silas Hoskins. Julia Wright is here. And so we'll have a panel discussion. Ms. Marshall, please go first. Okay, if you would please. Let's give her our hand. Can you give us some more light so Ms. Marshall can see her notes? There you can. Come on, you can do it, because I had big light. There you go. How's that?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Good afternoon again. I would like to express my appreciation, first of all, for all of the supporters, those of you who are here to support the Elaine Legacy Center and the descendants of the 1919 massacre. Just realize whatever we are sharing with you today, be it known how bad this story is. It will run synonymously with the story when the Queen of Sheba went to see the king. She had heard of all the royalty and the riches, but when she got there, she discovered that the half had not been told. What we will share with you today, and I don't know what happened to my light. What we will share with you today, consider, thank you so much, that the hell has not been told. In the fall of September 1919, Black farmers met to discuss getting better prices for their cotton. Before the 1919 massacre, the population in Elaine was probably 4 or 5 times greater than what census revealed today, 636 people living in Elaine. In addition to the great population that used to exist in Elaine, the town was filled with a multitude of people, so much until you could not walk on the sidewalks. People came from far and near. They came because Elaine was a flourishing place. Rich farmland, good timber cutting land, construction. and many blacks, contrary to popular belief, own their own businesses. And they indeed own their own land. You had a few people who were actually sharecroppers, but black people own their own land. Someone took a document from the courthouse a few months ago, and I discovered that my granddaddy owned 5,000 acres of land. Yeah. Today, we might have 300 and something that's owned. What happened to the land? While the war had brought high cotton prices to the Delta, black planters felt that they had not received their prices for their cotton. So in 1919, the massacre, in the fall, black farmers met to discuss getting better prices for their cotton. They had negotiated better prices if they were to ship their cotton by rail to Boston. This meant they would circumvent the unfair prices offered from Helena-based cotton companies, according to oral histories that has been handed down to the descendants of Elaine. The farm owners had waited to sell their crops until their representative returned from the World Cotton Conference in New Orleans, where they get prices, firsthand rates. Then agreement was made with Boston buyers. The oral narrative tells us owners of the Helena Cotton Company discovered the plan. They sent people with guns to stop the farmers. The progressive farmers met in a church just outside of Elaine, which was called Hootsburg. And it was rumored that just as people take rumors out of context today and falsify information, it was rumors that the black progressive farmers meeting was about raising an insurrection against the whites. The change that gave hope to some blacks provoked fear in some whites. Yeah. Farmers worked long hours daily in the cotton fields, planting, chopping, and picking cotton, charging food and merchandise to local stores. They had a difficult time working and working out their debt. Every landowner who had to charge food and merchandise was often cheated. We use the term pencil whipped when they add charges to your bill that you did not make. Sharecroppers could never win. They were often told, "You almost made it out of debt this year." As a result of blacks meeting to get their prices for their cotton, violence broke out. Apparently some white person from Helena was notified about the meeting and they came to the church at Hootsburg near Elaine. Shots were fired into the church where the black farmers were meeting. Apparently, the black farmers anticipated trouble because they too had firearms.
Yeah.
It was said that they fired back, killing a special railroad agent. And the news got back to Helena. When the news got to Helena, then they formed a posse and they came to Elaine. Hunting down blacks like they were animals. I'm told that they loaded up the whites, children and adults, women adults, and hauled them out of town. And then they shot the blacks down on sight. Many went to the woods and they were hunted down. Many massacres broke out in 1919, over 19 or 20 massacres, but Elaine was the deadliest slaughtering of them all. Governor Bowe called in the army soldiers to restore order, as it was said. But the story goes, it wasn't exactly like it was said. It seemed like he was on the wrong side of the law.
Yeah.
It was said as the blacks were coming out of the hiding places, as they had hired soldiers to come in and help. And the soldiers were coming in trusting that the soldiers came to help them, just like today when we call the police, we expect the police to come help us. Not take our lives and our children's lives.
Yeah.
They were trusting the soldiers to help, but instead, the story was handed down that the soldiers were also shooting down blacks. Some blacks were taken to jail, accused of various charges. Some were killed, many were killed. They went to court, the ones that were taken to jail. They had a brief trial, sometimes lasting as least as 2 minutes and no longer than 12 minutes, all white jurors. And they reached a verdict in little or no time. And in some cases, they faced harsh, unfair, unjust punishment. I'm told that justice is a place that is hallowed. And these people saw no justice. 12 black men were sentenced to death for murder. And it took only 12 minutes to come to that conclusion. But they appealed to a higher court. The NAACP helped finance the appeal. The Elaine 12 were freed when they had been condemned to death. If we are truly entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, we should not have to deal with so much injustice, police brutality, discrimination, loss of land, unreturned, white supremacy, racial terror, and other wrongs unconfessed. Murder. Many families were scattered after the massacre. Many ran away and changed their names because they were afraid that they would be found and whatever name that they was wearing was the prime target. So they changed their name. Some left and they never came back. We have a democracy that does not have equity for all. destroying the lives of those in that massacre, also killed the dreamer and stopped the dream in many cases. Parents could have passed on their legacy, endorsing quality education. They could have established their morals and values and standards to their families. They could have left land to children, and you know land is a valuable asset. Right. But land was stolen. Deeds, the name on the deeds were changed. And even when you didn't pay taxes, you didn't go 30 miles every day to see what was posted on the courthouse wall. So you didn't know that your land was delinquent. And people took land in a lot of ways. I kind of wonder sometimes what happened to our land, 5,000 acres diminished to 300 and some acres or less. Today in Elaine, we are still poor. Some of the poorest people in the world living on the richest soil of the United States. And this horrible event left a fear in the descendants that's taken them more than a century to live it down. Today, people are apprehensive about talking about the massacre. We realize that we can't stop here. We got to keep fighting. We have to keep our sword in our hand, and we must fight on. There is no amount of money that is equivalent to the value of a person's life. But if I say there is something that can be done to appease, we cry reparations. We're looking for restorative justice. We lost lives, land, labor, the pursuit of happiness. And if we could scream, give it all back, that would be our cry. But I believe the only answer to amend some of the problems would be reparations. Help me say that, reparations. 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 Thank you.
Julia Wright, are you there?
Yes, can you hear me?
We hear you loud and clear. How are you, sister?
Fine, thank you, Wendell. I'm sorry I didn't hear your remarks. But I'm sure they were inspiring.
Well, we're ready to hear your inspiring remarks. You're alive and clear to go.
Okay, well, I will begin by saying that I am so proud to be with you all, that my father, Richard Wright, is beaming. His uncle, Silas Hoskins, was lynched in Elaine in 1916 for the same reason that the 1919 massacre took place 3 years later. Economic jealousy, financial envy, and refusal of our desire for Black political independence. I know you spoke about Black amnesia, Wendell, and Amnesia is the most carefully made in USA product, and its main weapon is black silence, directly or indirectly imposed. Black amnesia and black silence are two peas in a pod. Black silence stifles our black narrative, to which we have a birthright, a human right. We are surrounded from our black childhood onwards by codes of silence imposed often by those who love us best, but who don't want to see us get lynched. Shush, children, you must be seen but not heard, we were told. As Wendell told you, in my father's black boy, the 9-year-old child who was my father, said to his mother, after he realized that his uncle had been lynched, quote, "But mom, why have we not fought back?" And his mother slapped him into silence. She was so afraid. That's black silence. My father was writing about. When Toni Morrison went down south to research, to conduct research for her book, Beloved, she visited black families to ask them if by any chance they had any artifacts left over from slavery in their attics that she could describe in her book. Members of the families she visited looked away and were silent. She wondered if they were ashamed of these remnants of past subservience, black silence. In his 1967 Riverside Church speech, Martin Luther King says prophetically, "There comes a time when silence is betrayal." Black silence. When we are faced with white terror, we go into fight or flight, or we freeze and we go mute. When we lose a loved one, like we black folks do disproportionately, the first phase of mourning is all too human denial. Black silence. So while we accept that black silence may be caused by human reactions like fear, shame, denial, PTSD, mourning, our own science is weaponized against us by a state intent on genocide. The state feeds on our black silence. Black silence is the state's fossil fuel. The state says, we black folks do not exist, and therefore we have no memories, nothing to say. We have nothing to say, therefore we do not exist. There is a time for black silence to the extent that it is human, and it can even give us healing time. But then there is a time for breaking our silence. Now is the time. Breaking silence is a joyful thing, a beautiful thing, a transformative thing. When we speak up, speak out, and speak out loud, we will realize we are walking and breathing history. We will know that we are capable of creating history with our bare hands in real time, right now. I always remember the children of Elaine with their hands in the soil where my great uncle was lynched. They were creating history in real time. We will know that we carry the land stolen from us in our bones, that we remember the marooning in our ancestral DNA. If they want to rob us of our history, they will have to re-enslave us first. Wow. I want to end with a feeling of sheer delight that I have to share with you, a gift. When I looked at the wording of today's invitation, I was thrilled. James, Lenora, and I are seen forever in history as, quote, descendants, unquote. If I ever have a calling card printed, I'm not the type, I will not miss not being a doctor or a PhD, because I will proudly print after my name the word descendant. Descendant means we embody a continuum of history. Descendant means we are passing that history on as long as we break our silence. The title of Descendants makes us timeless. The title of Descendants means we own the narrative of our past in the same way we own the lands illegally stolen from us.
Yes.
We are blessed with that history and that title. Thank you.
Joey, you're going to hear from the descendants. The descendants. James White, you want the mic? You want this? Or you want to sit in?
Yeah, I can do it.
I want to thank y'all for having me. I am a descendant of Elaine. I want to tell you a little story. My grandmother was Louise White. She was born 1904. She was 15 when the massacre happened. And she used to tell me about these bad stories that people was getting killed, and she saw people getting killed. And I really, when she first told me, I just really couldn't believe it, because I was a kid myself. But she didn't tell me the bad stuff all at once. It just grew over years. But you think about a 15-year-old child seeing people get murdered, shot down like dogs, just for the land that they had. My grandfather was Henry White. He was born January the 21st, 1888. He used to tell me about any given day, you could go out and see a black person hung up. And you couldn't even cut him down. He just had to stay there. So people went through a lot in Elaine. They got this story here that don't nobody want to talk about. They don't want to talk about it. White people don't want to talk about it because they got all the land. Black people don't want to talk about it because they are afraid. And let me tell you something, people, fear is a terrible thing. Fear Fear is a terrible thing. Ain't they a black person in here right now? If a police get behind you, you don't get nervous. Cause you do. That's just living in America. And they said American dream. Let me tell you, people, that's what it is, a dream. Cause you'll never get that house, you'll never get ahead. You can get ahead, but you gotta work extra hard. So it's a lot going on. I'm not a speaker. I won't stand here all day and bore you with my stuff. But let me tell you, this is real. This is real. Before 1919, black people owned the land. It was doctors, lawyers, dealerships. And I know for some of y'all, it's kind of hard to believe. Do your research. They own it. They own the land. Basically, in Philadelphia County, black people just not own all the land. So, don't be fed into these stories that black people didn't own the land. They didn't own nothing after 1919. So after 3 days, everything was gone for a black person. We have no generational wealth. We can't take care of ourselves. They took all the land. Now, this land, they make millions and millions off this land to the day. And people always come around and talk about this and that and how can you do this. They done took our wealth. They took our, when they took the land, they took away everything. My grandfather said, when people came back from the war, World War I, people was coming in and buying land. Not a lot of land, 10 acres, 20 acres, because they had to clean it up. But by 1919, when they got this little land and they were growing cotton, corn, beans, somebody got jealous and they wanted them. So they took it. That's what they did. Then they put fear in us. And I'm going to go back on from what Wendell said earlier. We need something new. We need something new. Because all you people that go to school and got these big educations and all that, y'all ain't coming up with nothing new. We gonna do the same old thing. We can't even take care of ourselves. And for some reason, white people wanna think they know what's the best for black people. Always. Always. You put a long way up there, and then you said we're lazy. You people need to come up with something new. You can be black, white, you know. Hey, this is a rainbow thing. We got to work together. So let me go back to this here. Let me go back to this here. And I'm going to get on down. We definitely need something new. Because let me give you a little thing in Phillips County. That Mr. Norris said with so many people there, even in my lifetime, there's a lot of people there. But they lied, they changed the game. They've been saying share problems for so long, people just not believe. So who gonna tell? All the older people gone. Who gonna tell our young people? If you gonna invest in your youth, if you don't invest in them, because of that, right now, they closing all our schools down. Don't nobody got a clue.
Right.
They don't got a clue. Our kids out of control. And that's some of these people that go to school and got these big educations. They can't even think of a plan. I got a daughter that's a teacher. She don't have any control over the class, so how can she teach the kids? Think about it. How can you teach your kids? Now people are so scared, they don't want to discipline your kids. And the kids know that. So y'all got to come up with something new. 20 years from now, what we going to be? We can't control the kids. They don't want to work. And I'm not talking about all kids. It's a lot of smart kids out there. But we need a new game. Second of all, I want to say something. This shirt has
descendants of Eli.
Now, it's two descendants of Eli and Elaine. Which to me never made no sense. We were there first.
Look out. That's the truth.
But this is the thing. You got a person that want to put a memorial in front of the courthouse where they found hundreds of people. But that's what people do when they got money. When white people got money, they do kind of what they want to do. Then they want to change the narrative.
Right.
And just because I'm this color here, don't mean I'm on the right side. We're already done told you. If you listen. But Eli Lincoln Center was the first there. The other one, just somebody that want to change the narrative. And if this person want to help black people at Elaine, he could get our 40 acres.
Oh, look out.
And our track. We got you new, you track. You got people always coming there. I want to help. I want to help. They don't want to help. They want to take away. They want to change the narrative. They want to say, that sheriff problem, the sheriff problem. Come on, people. We need a new game. Y'all better wake up. Black people was landowners. I don't know if you ever heard of Ferguson. Ferguson was black owned. It's south of Elaine.
Yeah.
And then it was Fermont. Fermont was black owned. These people owned all the land down there. And right now, guess what they're doing, people? It ain't no more Ferguson. It's
right.
Fermont.
Right.
They changing everything. You got people that don't even want us to know our history. They don't even want us to know. How are we going to tell our kids if we don't, if we can't tell them?
Right.
So, I want y'all to think of yourself. We got to change the game. We got to come up with something different. Thank y'all.
How many of you have heard directly from descendants of Elaine before today?
Thank you, Christy. We have a new rendered version, and the only thing that I can do is try it and hope that he was able to get all the voice tracks uploaded, so we can do that at any time.
Okay. I think the way I would I'd like to have the Q&A after the documentary, because it answers more, it fills in more of the story for us. So I'm going to ask, we're going to do a grand applause for the descendants later. Let's do it both now anyway. Truth and your stories with us, and that applause also reached across the ocean to Julia Wright. Okay. We're going to step off the stage. Chris, roll it.
Okay, we'll say goodbye to Julia right now as well. Thank you for being with us, Julia.
Bless you, Julia. Talk to you on Zoom next time.